My name is Kim Connolly, and I have the honor of being chair of the 2010 to 2011 Mitchell Lecture Committee. And I am so excited that this day is finally here. All this hard work, and now we can participate in a truly amazing event. As you can read about in your programs and we'll hear from later speakers, we are celebrating two historic occasions and making new history here with three amazing lecturers. This lecture series was endowed in 1950 by a gift from Lavinia A. Mitchell in memory of her husband, James McCormick Mitchell. We have had many notable speakers deliver marvelous lectures over the years and are delighted to be adding to this prestigious list this year. My job is to thank the folks behind the scenes and turn over introductions to our marvelous dean. So let me just take a few minutes to tell you about the people who made today possible for you. First, Professor Fred Konieski, who served as de facto co-chair, coming up with the original idea and shepherding the process throughout, including up until late last night and early this morning, being on top of the details. And committee member Professor Tara Mellish. She's the director of the Buffalo Human Rights Center, and she has worked hard in the planning phase and will be working hard today as your moderator. Second, Eileen Fleischman, our PR maven, has done a great job with the publicity and other arrangements. And Terry McCormick, who took care of all of the IT and all of our logistics. He was just truly wonderful. Anita Mazurek, who was our chief administrator on this and did miracle workers and was just doing things until the very last minute to make sure that it was going to be perfect. There were a lot of other people who gave us help as well. In the AV, Anne-Marie Schwartz. In the library, compiling information, Theo Belniak, Marcia Zubrow, Beth Edelman, John Mondo, John Gherkin. In university archives, Karen Spencer, who has since retired but worked hard on this until, and Bill Offhaus. Helping Eileen was Lisa Mueller. Doing our website was Christina Lively. And Amy Atkinson, event planner, helped as well. If I've forgotten anybody, I so apologize, but there are lots of people who helped today happen, and I appreciate every single one of them. And now I will turn it over to Dean Matua, who will tell us a little bit about our esteemed lecturers. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Kim. And thank you all for coming to this 2010-2011 Mitchell Lecture series. I would like, first of all, to recognize the esteemed members of the judiciary who are here today. A large number of you have shown up to hear this lecture, and I want to thank you for coming to be with us today. So welcome. Let's give them a hand. I also like to welcome our students, our faculty, our staff, and our alumni who have come here today to listen to this lecture and to participate in it. So welcome one and all. The 2010-2011 edition of this lecture revisits a significant historical moment for UB Law and what I like to think of the undying quest for human rights. We celebrate today a major address by U.S. Supreme Court Justice Robert H. Jackson, given at the University at Buffalo exactly some 65 years ago. Justice Jackson had taken a leave of absence from the U.S. Supreme Court to serve as a chief prosecutor at the International Military Tribunal in Nuremberg. And that tribunal is commonly known as the Nuremberg War Crimes Tribunal. The tribunal, as you all know, was formed by the victorious Allies over the Axis powers after the defeat and surrender of the Nazis in the Second World War. Justice Jackson spoke at UB immediately after he returned home from that historic experience at Nuremberg. His speech, which resonates today, touched on a number of timeless themes, some of which we are reliving today. How a warlike spirit can overcome a nation. The quest for nations to work together cooperatively in the course of peace. the interrelationships of war and dictatorship, and the supremacy of law over the lawless forces of war and persecution. However, as some of you may know, Justice Jackson had his detractors, none of whom was more important than his boss, Chief Justice Harlan Fiske Stone, who attacked him, saying, and I quote, "So far as the Nuremberg trial is an attempt to justify the application of power of the victor to the vanquished, because the vanquished made aggressive war, I dislike extremely to see it dressed up with a false facade of legality. The best that can be said of it is that it is a political act of the victorious state, which may be morally right." He went on, "It would not disturb me greatly if that power were openly and frankly used to punish the German leaders for being a bad lot. But it disturbs me some to have it dressed up in the habiliments of the common law and the constitutional safeguards to those charged with crime." Jackson is away conducting his high-grade lynching party in Nuremberg. I don't know why the Chief Justice used the word lynching, but there he did. "I don't mind what he does to the Nazis, but I hate to see the pretense that he is running a court and proceeding according to common law. This is a little too sanctimonious a fraud to meet my old-fashioned ideas." End of quote. Of course, Justice Jackson's view and his life's work would be vindicated some 70 years later in 2003 in the establishment of the International Criminal Court, a permanent war crimes tribunal to try the most heinous crimes known to man. I leave it up to the panelists to arbitrate between Justice Jackson and his boss, Harlan Fiske Stone. This event today also marks a second anniversary as well, the 60th year of the Mitchell Lecture Series, whose first installment featured none other than Justice Jackson speaking in 1951 on the subject of wartime security and liberty and the law. It's a rich subject that we are going to be hearing today from our panelists, and I hope that we all participate fully in it. Professor Carley did thank the committee that organized and conceptualized this event and got all these wonderful speakers to join us, but I would like to add my own thanks to the committee and to Professor Connolly in particular for stewarding the committee in this direction. I recognize Eileen Fleischman, who is the maven, as she was called, of publicity and outreach, as you all know, those who are alumni. Terry McCormack, our whiz for technology and logistics, and of course, Professors Melish, Miller, Kanowski, who was so wonderful in helping out this year. I also wish to welcome and thank the distinguished guests, in addition to the judges who have joined us today. I welcome all of you. And I, in particular, want to mention the folks from the Jackson Center in Jamestown who have come here today. And now I would like to say a few words about our speakers, our distinguished panel of speakers. These three distinguished academics have traveled far to headline this event. And I just want to say thank you for gracing us with your presence. Professor John Q. Barrett, from St. John's University in New York City. He's a board member of the Jackson Center in Jamestown, New York. He will be addressing the topic of bringing Nuremberg home, Justice Jackson's path back to Buffalo, October 4th, 1946. Professor Barrett is an internationally renowned expert on Justice Jackson and is writing a biography of the justice. Professor Eric L. Muller from the University of North Carolina School of Law is a legal historian with a special interest in the Japanese internment cases during World War II. He will discuss the topic of Nazis, Americans, and the law as a peace profession. And my good friend from California, although she is not there today, Professor Mary L. Dziak, the judge Edward J. and Roy L. Quirado Professor of Law, History, and Political Science at the University of Southern California. She is currently the John Hope Franklin Visiting Professor of American Legal History at Duke Law School. She will speak on the subject of rumors of war. It is exciting for us, for our students, our faculty, our staff, our legal community in Western New York, to have a chance to explore these topics with you all, with these prominent visitors. May I ask you to stand and give them a standing, a rousing ovation, please. Thank you very much. I hope that at the end of the lectures, we shall have another opportunity to stand up and cheer again. No pressure here. Now, let me turn over the microphone to my fellow professor, the director of the UB Law Human Rights Center, Professor Tara Mellish, who will moderate the discussion. Thank you so much.
Again, as the director of the Buffalo Human Rights Center, it's my distinct honor and pleasure to be here to moderate this highly distinguished panel. As they've been introduced already by Dean Matua, we will proceed directly to the presentations. Professor Eric Muller will begin. I'm sorry, Professor Barrett will begin, and then Professor Muller and Professor Dziak. We will have time for questions at the end. These lectures will be, I promise you, they will be provocative and challenging to all of us, and I know we will have many questions and comments and thoughts at the end, and I encourage all of you to participate. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon. Let me begin by joining in the thank yous, because there are many here that are richly deserved. I begin with Dean Matua for the generous remarks and for the sponsorship institutionally and his leadership, Professors Kim Connolly, Alfred Konevsky, Tara Mellish, and their other colleagues and students who carry the Mitchell tradition forward in this lecture series and carry the great tradition of this law school forward. I'd like to thank James McCormick Mitchell and his descendants. His name is on this lecture, and the descendants include his law firm, Phillips Lytle, represented here today. And I wish to thank this great formative city of Buffalo, which is a large part of what we're talking about, particularly this great University of Buffalo, historically and today in the New York State University system, including this University at Buffalo School of Law, and my friends here in Buffalo, in Erie County, in Chautauqua County, to the south, and much more widely, who are leaders in the work of the Robert H. Jackson Center. Also, the bench, bar, teachers, and students of Buffalo have my thanks. I thank my friends Eric and Mary. They are both superb scholars. They're high on the list of best friends who you don't get to see very often in my life, and so this is a personal pleasure to have them here. Mary is a leading light in so many ways, and if you're not a customer and a regular visitor to the Legal History blog, is one place to glimpse her work make that part of your habit. Her book that's coming out, I think we will get a preview of this afternoon. Eric is many wonderful things, and in addition to all of his legal skills, he's a rock star, but that's a different story. And go to YouTube. I'd also like to thank the ghosts of some legal giants, Buffalo legal giants, who are here with us, or at least connected to our presence this afternoon. They include, and I wish I had time to do justice and explain who each of these is, Thomas Penny, Henry Killeen, John Lord O'Brien, David Diamond, James McCormick Mitchell, Judge Charles S. Desmond, Manly Fleischman, Daniel Kennefick, Dean Francis Shea, Professor and then Dean Louis Jaffe, Justice Philip Halpern, General William J. Donovan, Philip Wixer, and many, many others. Now, I don't wish to date anybody, but for people of a certain age, I've just recited the starting lineup in the legal all-star, not just Buffalo or Western New York, but I think profession of its era, and their echo connects to the Jackson story and what we're doing here. And I add one more name, singling him out because a very special place on this roster, which I will discuss, belongs to Justice and later Judge Charles Brown Sears, whose actions across three decades made possible so much of what brings us together this afternoon. We commemorate here the second of Buffalo's Robert H. Jackson, three major lectures across one huge decade in the history of this country and the world, which he delivered here at the University of Buffalo. The last of those three Jackson UB lectures, widely known, was his May 9, 1951 inaugural Mitchell Lecture. And I think both Eric and Mary will be addressing that in their remarks. The first, the other bookend, on February 23, 1942, so coming up on an anniversary year, was then rookie Supreme Court Justice Robert H. Jackson's speech here at the University of Buffalo, Youth Faces the New Order, which he delivered at the 42nd annual mid-year convocation commencement in the Edmund Hayes Hall, part of the University Center at the time. Perhaps we will all be back here in February to commemorate the 70th anniversary of that compelling speech, in which Jackson, personally and intrinsically Pacific and no warrior, speaks as a high official of a country newly at war, facing very candidly the uncertain and perhaps bleak prospects for the future in that winter of 1942. Between those bookends, 1942 and 1951, is the second of Jackson's University of Buffalo lectures. It is, of course, the Mitchell Lecture that occurred 65 years ago today, October 4, 1946. Jackson, who wrote all of his own speeches and judicial opinions and articles and letters and fishing trip reports and you name it, gave that speech no title. I think it did not need one. Who Jackson was and where he had come from immediately at that moment, the just completed Nuremberg trial, was obviously his topic. And it was part of what made his speech at that centennial convocation of the University of Buffalo so electrifying to its audience and so very significant in its time. Now, in this lecture, I will chart three paths as we consider Justice Jackson's path back to Buffalo. The first is Jackson's path to Nuremberg. The second is Jackson's two paths to Buffalo, one for the 1946 speech and one earlier. And the third is the general Jackson path that he discussed in that lecture, the path of law and education. And then I will have three concluding thoughts. Let me begin with Jackson's path to Nuremberg. It begins here and now there in a farmhouse on the banks of the Broken Straw Creek in Spring Creek, Pennsylvania. That's where he was born in 1892 in rural beauty and isolation. You see the New England architectural style. His forebears were Connecticut Yankees who'd come west and settled and cleared land and built log cabins and worked their way up to building this house. That's downtown Spring Creek on a busy afternoon, I think, in Jackson's boyhood. The hill in the background is called Eldred Hill. His mother's family was his grandmother's family was a descendant of the Eldred chain, and one hill in that valley is Eldred Hill, and the other is called Jackson Hill. From that rural beginning, the family moved north across the New York state line, so we're heading towards Buffalo. His father was not cut out for farming. He was more of a wheeler dealer, and he moved the family to Frewsburg, New York, a small town up the valley from Spring Creek and Warren, Pennsylvania. And Jackson attended modest schools in Frewsburg, graduating in 1909 as the valedictorian from the Frewsburg High School. That's Jackson as a 17-year-old valedictorian. Soon, after a year at the Jamestown High School, after an apprenticeship, after a year at the Albany Law School, without a year of college education, without a day of college education, Robert H. Jackson was a 21-year-old lawyer, hanging out a shingle, starting a solo practice, which became a two-man shop, which moved from non-paying clients to paying clients, and the arc went upward from there. This is Jackson in the early 20s as a member of the Chautauqua County Bar. This is Jackson that same year, looking a little smug on the left side of the photo, looking quite dapper, on vacation in the depths of winter in Puerto Rico, which tells you a bit about his economic trajectory. And this is Jackson a few years later. You can't pick him out of the crowd. You see it's the American Bar Association annual dinner meeting here in Buffalo in the Elwood Music Hall. Buffalo, the 10th largest city of the United States, was in this year the host of the ABA's annual meeting. And in the far, far back, I can't see them either, but I know from a seating chart on one of the tables you can't see is Robert Jackson and his wife, Irene. And a year later, this is Jackson, again on the left side, maybe looking a little pensive because of all these overly dressed people, on his boat on Chautauqua Lake, which gives you another glimpse of his economic trajectory. Now that path is a legal profession path, and of course it's got some prosperity, which indicates some success, built into it. But it also had a political dimension. Way back when he was just a year or two after that young high school valedictorian in 1909, when he was a law apprentice in 1911, Jackson's mentor, who was a Democratic committee man, a graduate of the University of Buffalo Law School named Frank Mott, took his boy Jackson with him to Albany and introduced him to lots of people, and I'm sure much political handshaking occurred. One of the handshakes was 18-year-old Jackson meeting 28-year-old freshman New York State Senator Frank Roosevelt. Neither one found the other particularly memorable. Jackson, of course, was just a boy from the boondocks, and Frank Roosevelt sure had a fancy name, but he was a feather duster is what the Republicans believed he embodied on the wrong branch of the Roosevelt family tree. That's what the initials stood for, and he was fancy and handsome and rich, but he wasn't going anyplace. And of course, in time, that Jackson trajectory up through the legal profession includes continuing involvement in Democratic politics, and that Frank Roosevelt becomes Franklin, conquers polio, becomes a governor, becomes a president, and as you notice, stands vigorously and grips that pole as if he barely needs it, with his protege Jackson, one person to his left. This is the early 1930s, 1935, a year into Jackson's service in the New Deal in Washington. He went to be the general counsel of the Revenue Bureau and the Treasury Department, today the IRS Office of General Counsel. It was the biggest law office on earth. He was the chief counsel of a 200 lawyer shop, which dwarfed the Department of Justice, which dwarfed every private law firm in the United States. It was an administrative job, and Jackson had no patience for that. He liked to lawyer, and he wasn't that good at it. So he quickly sloughed it off on his deputy and began to litigate the nation's most high-profile cases, producing this and many other such indicia a year later, magazine coverage and national headline roles. In Pittsburgh, during the spring of 1935, Jackson prosecuted the civil tax fraud case against Andrew W. Mellon, who had been the Secretary of Treasury under Harding and Coolidge, briefly Hoover, then the ambassador in London, and was either a monstrous tax cheat or a political persecution victim, depending on one's view of that case of the century. Well, the judges of the Tax Court of Appeals rendered a large judgment in Jackson's favor. He cleaned the clock of Andrew W. Mellon in the cross-examination, and Frank Hogan, the president of the American Bar Association, Mellon's lawyer, who famously said there's nothing better as a client than a wealthy man who's scared, probably was talking about that situation. And from there, Jackson went into New Deal constitutional defense work. This is the trio defending the constitutionality of the Public Utility Holding Company Act, Jim Landis on the left, and Jackson, the third fellow, has not remained as prominent. And that becomes the path to constitutional litigation in the Justice Department. By Roosevelt's appointment, Jackson's second nomination and senatorial confirmation is as an assistant attorney general. He first heads the tax division. Then he's transferred over to the antitrust division. Then Roosevelt appoints Jackson in 1938 Solicitor General of the United States, which is this beautiful desk and office, and is a job to argue before these nine justices. This is the court of 1937. You can see the turn has started to occur because the back row right is Justice Hugo L. Black, the first of Roosevelt's appointees. In other words, this is still the court of Hughes in the center and Brandeis to his left and Cardozo in the back row right and the four horsemen, but the path is changing. And Jackson, as Solicitor General, argues nearly 50 cases to this court in a two-year period and wins most of them. Then in 1940, he becomes Attorney General of the United States. It comes with a big conference room. Jackson found this unworkably large, so this posed photo is him at his secretary's desk because he said, what would I do with a room so large? But this is the AG's conference room. And from there, the path might have gone even higher. This is a typical headline from early 1940. Roosevelt's choice for president is Bob Jackson. Because Franklin, become two-term president Roosevelt, at that point in time was at least playing coy, but I think probably sincerely contemplating observing the American tradition of retiring after two terms. He'd broken ground in his presidential library at Hyde Park a couple years earlier. He had signed a contract to edit and write for a magazine. Something like Jefferson at Monticello was the idea of this Roosevelt in retirement at Hyde Park. And where would the Democrats then turn? Well, into the youth of the New Deal, into the next generation, and perhaps to this man as the standard bearer. World events, and then Roosevelt, and then voters, of course, had other ideas. And so Jackson's path led here. He's now the rookie in the back row right, appointed to the Supreme Court in 1941. And in this role, his writing, his voting includes participation in notable war cases, a category to think on, and I will hear more about it later. They include ex parte querying, in which he votes but does not write. They include West Virginia State Board of Education versus Barnett, in which he, of course, writes for the court, striking down the compulsory flag salute. They include Hirabayashi versus United States, in which he votes as part of the court that unanimously upholds the curfew order imposed by the Army and the executive branch with criminal penalties on people of Japanese descent. And it includes Korematsu versus United States, in which he writes as one of the three dissenters from the court upholding the military exclusion orders for which Fred Korematsu was prosecuted for violating. That's a four-year period in which Jackson is making the transition from advocacy and executive branch to judicial and independence. He's not extremely happy on the court. There are tensions with colleagues who he thinks don't have quite the proper model of the job, and he contemplates returning to things he loves, Western New York, law practice, etc. And again, events intervene. Franklin Roosevelt dies, and World War II in the European theater is won. And before the month of April is out, this new president of the United States reaches out to the man he personally regards, and I think it's fair to say the country generally regards, as America's finest lawyer. The request from Truman, accepted by Jackson, I think at the basic level of not so sure he liked the Supreme Court anyway, and when your president asks, it's correct to say yes, is to be the chief of counsel of the United States for the prosecution of Nazi war criminals in the European theater. Focus on the date. It's late April 1945. The job coincides with the Supreme Court's summer recess. Jackson did his own writing and quickly, so his opinions were done for the term. They hadn't quite recessed, but it was coming, and then he would have some months off. And what he was told was, your country needs you to do this. It will be a stature that the United States contributes to an alliance project. There are cases ready to go. The evidence has been assembled. There are defendants who are about to be captured. And principally, this will be the trial of Adolf Hitler. perhaps a few other co-defendants who will be captured with him imminently. Jackson says yes. He drafts and Truman signs an executive order. They both sign on the dotted line, and within days, this balloon pops in every way. There is no Allied agreement. There is no more Adolf Hitler. There is no assembled evidence. There is no legal plan how to do this. There is no prospect of doing it quickly. And Jackson is on the hook. So it turns out that he misses a full year in the life of the Supreme Court for the project that we call Nuremberg. That's the first path. Let me turn to the second path, two paths really, Jackson's paths to Buffalo. It begins, in a sense, in the summer of 1946, and now I'm focusing on the path to the Mitchell, not the Mitchell lecture, to the Centennial lecture that he gives a year hence. Over the summer of 1945, Jackson and Allied counterparts negotiate in London and they work out the creation of the world's first international criminal court, the International Military Tribunal. This is Jackson signing the London Agreement on August 8, 1945. They then fly to Nuremberg. This is everybody but the Russians who were not being permitted by Moscow to go quite yet, but eventually they showed up too. You notice the sexism of the time, and I want to note the theme that runs through my list of lawyers and this photograph and et cetera, was the reality of the man's world, which was the distorted and excluded world of Jackson's time. But one State Department lawyer is the woman in the skirt, one of Jackson's principal aides, Catherine Fite. And in Nuremberg, they find this, a city that the Allies had bombed to smithereens in 1944 and 1945. That is the Adolf Hitler plots in front of the Frauenkirche, the church you see in the back right. This is another shot of that square. A couple of months after the surrender and the Allied occupation, it's been swept clean. But that's the reality of Nuremberg. And they also find this, which is a standing, although bomb damaged in one wing, courthouse. And behind it, as you see in the half wheel and spoke, it had an incredibly important additional feature. A surviving sizable prison. So looking at the front, you see the courthouse with a missing section. You see an adjunct building, and those top windows are the courtroom. And you see this cell block, which can accommodate a large number of prisoners, prospective defendants, material witnesses, etc. And there in Nuremberg, they soon fly four Allied flags on a formerly German courthouse. And they rehabilitate and commence a trial in this courtroom. They bring charges against 24 individuals plus six Nazi organizations. 24 becomes 22 due to one death and one determination of incompetency. And one of the 22 was being tried in absentia. So we're talking 21 real individuals in the dock. This is Jackson opening the trial. His opening statement on November 21, 1945 is one of the most spellbinding, permanently significant, eloquent speeches in English history. You see the bench to Jackson's right, the eight judges, two from each of the Allied nations, a principal and an assistant, British, American, French, and Russian judge. And over the course of the next 8 months, Jackson and his staff for the United States and his counterparts in the Allied teams prosecute this case. The crimes are four: conspiracy and substantive crimes of waging aggressive war, committing war crimes, and committing crimes against humanity in the first international criminal trial ever. Jackson does extensive trial work. This is a photograph you see on the far left in the witness box, Hermann Göring, and on the far right, Jackson at the podium cross-examining him. He was one of eight who Jackson cross-examined himself in the course of the trial. And by the summer of 1946, Jackson's part of this case against the individual defendants was done. This is Jackson summing up on July 26, 1945. From that point, Jackson is a spectator, and he briefly returns to the United States for August to prepare to return to the Supreme Court, where his work had accumulated, of course, during the missed year. And then he returns in late September for the judgment that the tribunal has been writing and will hand down. He didn't save his ticket stubs, unfortunately. So this is a British prosecution stub for the final judgment, which was returned, and you have to focus on the compressed dates here, on September 30 and October 1, 1946. On October 2, Jackson landed back in the United States. This is a photograph of him taken at National Airport. You can see the headline on the Washington Post, Goering, Ribbentrop, others, von Papen, two more freed, etc. You can see at the top that it was published on Friday, October 4, 1946. But by that point in time, Jackson wasn't even in Washington anymore. He was arriving in Buffalo. That's one of Jackson's paths to Buffalo. That's the through Nuremberg chief prosecutor arriving at UB to give the centennial lecture at the commencement on October 4th. Jackson's second path to Buffalo, an earlier path to Buffalo, the deep and life-defining path to Buffalo, began here. This is the county courthouse in Mayville, New York, located on the northern end of Chautauqua Lake. In this courthouse, young Jackson, a lawyer at age 21 in 1913, tried his first and first hundreds of cases. And by approximately 1916 or 17, in this courtroom, he appeared before a new New York State Supreme Court justice who was riding circuit and presiding in this courtroom, Charles B. Sears, a name, of course, of this institution. Charles Sears couldn't remember a couple of decades later how much actual trial work Jackson had done before him versus how much conversation on the margins of the trials Jackson had with him. What stuck in his memory was conversations outside of court where this young man impressed him as extremely deep, extremely talented, extremely interesting. And the milieu that made that possible was something like, frankly, the 19th century boarding houses where the justices of the John Marshall Court drank their port and Madeira and conferred after hours. The lawyers of Chautauqua County at the Inns of Mayville, down the road from this courthouse, judges and lawyers had those kinds of interactions. Well, for Charles Sears, that man made a mark, although he was quite young. And what Sears did was recruit him to Buffalo. Now, this is Jackson on the left. It's a little bit of a grainy picture, but he's the slip of a person next to his wife and his widowed mother and his 12-year-old sister. And he was the support and the livelihood for those three. Those were his dependents on which he petitioned and on which his draft board granted him an exemption from military service in the Great War, the World War, that began in that spring of 1917. Jackson's world goes from this, which is fishing with Irene in the Broken Straw Creek, across the creek from the birthplace, and this, which is Irene sitting in his Jamestown office, a nice little cubbyhole desk, but obviously quite a modest operation, to this, the biggest office building on earth. Now, later, of course, Jackson headed the world's biggest law office, but at the time this building was built, it was the biggest office building on earth. It's the Ellicott Square building. It's right downtown. It still stands in its majesty and glory. Because what Charles Sears did was told his friend Tom Penny, a great Buffalo lawyer, the Erie County District Attorney, the prosecutor of the assassin of President McKinley here in Buffalo in 1901, "Do I have the young trial lawyer for you?" Penny headed a firm, Penny, Killeen, and Nye, officed in this Ellicott Square building, which had a principal client, the International Railway Company, the streetcar company of Buffalo. And they offer Jackson a job, and he takes it. He goes to work, walking through this ornate lobby, taking the elevator up to the eighth floor. It's all still there, including the tile floor that he walked across many, many times. And I don't know if he ever remembered this, but when one walks through the Ellicott Square building today, knowing where the Jackson path went, this harmless 1917-1918 geometric design does sort of jump out and cause one to pull out his camera. And Jackson and his young wife, Irene, still no children, married just a year and a half, live here in Buffalo. This is Johnson Park on the west side in the historic district. This is the Lindhaven Building, built in 1901 as housing for the Pan American Exhibition, which of course attracted the president and then his assassin, and still standing today. It stands next to this white pillared building, which reputedly was the student home of Grover Cleveland when he was studying for the law in Buffalo in an earlier decade. It's a little pocket park. It's been cleaned up and rehabilitated, and behind the tree would be the building. You can see the doorway, and you can see the pillars of the Cleveland home to the left. And that's the Lindhaven directly, 49 Johnson Park, the Buffalo home of Bob and Irene Jackson during 1917 and 1918. About a 6-7 block walk to the Ellicott Square building, past the City Hall, past today the McKinley Monument, and so forth. That was his world. And he's trying cases at a furious pace in the state courts, in the federal courts, in the appellate division, writing briefs, appealing adverse jury verdicts in basic tort judgment cases against the trolley company. After 2 years in Buffalo, things align to bring Jackson back to Jamestown. One thing that's happened is that influenza is piling bodies on the curbs of Buffalo. That's the fall of 1918. Another thing that's happened is that Irene Jackson is now pregnant with their first child, William, born the next July. A third thing that's happened is that the Corporation Council of Jamestown, appointed by the Republican mayor, has been drafted to Washington for a federal appointment, creating a vacancy, causing the mayor to reach out to the best young lawyer he knows to pull him back from Buffalo. And a fourth thing that's happened is that young Jackson, having made lots of connections and developed early experience in Buffalo, has that but believes he can emerge quicker from the slight remove of Jamestown. And so for all of those reasons, moves back there to establish his base and practice. And this is a photo that tangibly proves that he's right. This isn't Grover Cleveland's house. This is Bob Jackson's house in Jamestown, built a couple of years later with the proceeds of his successful practice. And then, of course, it leads to Nuremberg with the intervening events that I've talked about. While there, Jackson gets this cable, a little hard to read, but the last paragraph, this is Jackson's office in Washington cabling him in May of 46. Judge Sears, Buffalo, requests Justice Jackson as guest of Buffalo University, October 3 and 4, to receive honorary degree on occasion of 100th anniversary. Would like immediate confirmation of Jackson acceptance. And Jackson promptly cables back. Please notify Judge Sears of acceptance and appreciation of his offer, period. The date suggested immediately precedes the opening of full-term Supreme Court, which creates some possibility of interference. A nice, gentle phrase. I might stiff you, is what Jackson's saying. And would have to give court duty high priority, period. So far as I can see, however, I can be present. And then he's back in Nuremberg, and then the tribunal delays its announcement of its decision, and then he's leaving Nuremberg on the night of October 1 to be back in Washington on October 2, to get a night train on October 3, to be in Buffalo on October 4. He makes the trip. And for the rest of his life, what began in 1917 and continued across this period is embodied in this lecture, continues to be a central part of Jackson. His deep, close, continuing ties to Buffalo, to its lawyers, to its bar, to its bench, to its great university. Now, path number three. Jackson's path in law and education. His 1946 speech, please read it, it's in the pamphlet, beautifully produced by UB, describes his salvage from Nuremberg, which is humanity's salvage, which is civilization's salvage. I forgot to give you this. This is the Kleinhans Music Theater, and that is, of course, the stage from which Jackson delivered the speech, a majestic building to visit today. Jackson makes 8 points in the speech he delivers on this centennial occasion, and at least 8 points, but I want to pull out 8 and very quickly tick them off. This is him at the podium, and this, to give you a feel for him, is the first page of his reading copy. You can see that he wrote a text. I think he wrote it on airplanes. He certainly wrote it himself, and he then marked it up for reading with breath marks and emphasis points. And he stressed the following things. Number one, the modern danger, threat, crime, security risks, etc., comes from the educated. Not little people, not obscure people. It's powerful, educated people who are the danger. Yet number two, education, ironically or in a complementary fashion, remains our best hope. And number three, Nuremberg as a topic of education is a new lesson in the realm of law. War, we now know, Nuremberg has established, is illegal in international law, as it has always been, Jackson says, in the moral order, and all individuals, even so-called statesmen, national leaders, heads of state, are now liable for this kind of lawbreaking. Number four, international law, he emphasizes, also reaches the related evils, the evils connected to war, things like tyranny, dictatorship, violations of minority rights. And thus, for nations, for what he was leaving the international stage and returning to the United States physically, there are choices to be made. And he describes forks in the road. On the one hand, nations can systematize tyrannical power, as happened in Nazi Germany, or as he was observing as he worked in Nuremberg in 1945, 1946, as was happening across the Eastern European nations that were under the domination of Soviet communism. Or, alternatively, the choice could be made, as in the US legal system, to place constitutional limits on majority power. Jackson draws that connection from domestic back to international and says, this is part of what Nuremberg is sending me and us home with. And he says, number six, that Nuremberg brings new higher standards, international standards, to guide the making of those national choices. We allies won on the battlefield and have now established in a courtroom the values and the higher orders, including protections for human rights, that hadn't been articulated with that kind of force and that kind of consensus before. That's another part of the education he brings home. Now, Jackson's speech, this is another page. You can see a little handwritten addendum on the side, which is about the IMT's conclusion that war was illegal. So in other words, it was typed before the judgment, and then he added in what the court had held, the October 1st part. And on the bottom, an addition about the death sentences. Statesmen are liable up to the level of risking their lives. I had to show you this because his day concludes with a dinner invitation. Mr. James McCormick Mitchell, our benefactor, invited Jackson to dinner that evening at the Saturn Club, a date I believe Jackson kept before catching the night train back to Washington. And the next day, of course, brought this to every newspaper in the country. This is the Buffalo Evening News. This is the New York Times. This is Vital Speeches of the Day a couple of weeks later. Jackson's message, the eloquent text you have, the 6 points I've itemized and two more I'm about to add, become part of the national conversation. The State Department propagates this through various media around the world because it's a message and he's a voice that states our perspective about what law is becoming. And the University of Buffalo gorgeously produces it in this book, which is the physical symbol of the centennial commemoration. So let me conclude. I want to conclude with a coincidence and then with Jackson's two final points. The coincidence is a little bit of a subtlety. It might be tucked into this letter. It's from Dave Diamond, a good close friend of Jackson's, Corporation Counsel of Buffalo, Jackson's friend for decades from Buffalo till the end of his life. Dear Bob, signed Dave, apologizing for not being at UB on October 4th. And he doesn't really explain why. This letter from Judge Charles Wazanski, a Jackson colleague in Washington, and by 1946 a federal judge in Boston, explains explicitly the coincidence that I think is worth noting. He's telling Jackson that he's been invited to speak at a conference. Robert Taft, senator from Ohio, famously spoke at this conference the next night at Kenyon College. But Wazanski says he is unable to participate. I cannot deliver my paper at Kenyon College as the authorities had scheduled my talk for a Jewish holiday. October 4, 1946, unlike today, was a Friday. But this Friday, like that Friday, at sundown, becomes Kol Nidre, becomes the start of Yom Kippur. And I suspect Jackson in 1946 was oblivious to this, not Jewish. Dave Diamond, Jewish, lots of Jackson's friends and colleagues, Jackson's Nuremberg Project in some dimensions, Jewish. But I suspect the University of Buffalo, in scheduling its centennial, was quite aware of this and had made sure that this Thursday-Friday event didn't create a Jewish holiday problem for those who have observed that faith. Now, the rest of Jackson's life is the Supreme Court, but the rest of Jackson's life is Nuremberg. And the two last parts of his 46 speech, that I want to point to as I leave you with this tableau of him and his smiling colleagues on the Supreme Court are the following. The first is Jackson's long view. This is point number 7 of his Nuremberg project. I won't quote it because his words deserve your direct reading, but read the final paragraph in the pamphlet of Jackson's October 4, 1946 speech. It's about Nuremberg coming to have its meaning long after Jackson's time will have passed. And of course, here we are. And here we are at the University of Buffalo, because point number 8 is a sentence tucked earlier in Jackson's speech, which I think also should jump out at you. UB is a site that, of course, he's speaking at in the music hall at Kleinhans, but also as a center of learning and education that matters to Jackson. And this phrase reaches us 65 years later. The Nuremberg trial is not unlikely to influence legal thought in this institution's second century. And of course, here we are, which is a great honor. Thank you very much.
The speech that we are commemorating today, Robert Jackson's convocation address on the occasion of the University of Buffalo's centennial, was odd in one respect, at least in my view, perhaps not in John Barrett's. It presented a thesis that it actually did not try to support. The argument at the outset of the speech was hardly surprising in a university setting. He said, and I'm quoting, "It is my conviction that improvement through education offers the last clear chance of civilization to avoid catastrophe." A big claim. But those were the last words directly relating to education in the address. He immediately moved on to a somewhat different matter, the utility of the Nuremberg trials in instilling and enforcing norms of peace in international law. What I'd like to do this afternoon is to offer some preliminary thoughts about how we might fill in some of the gaps in Justice Jackson's message about the value of education as a counterweight to wartime excess. What I'm going to do is I'm going to pair two stories of relatively high-ranking lawyers from different countries who oversaw the forced removal of racially defined state enemies during World War II, motivated not chiefly by virulent racism or by psychopathology, but by something more uncomfortable to acknowledge, motivated by the pressure of professional ambition. What I'm going to do is explore some of the all too human forces that tend to lead societies as they led Germany and the United States away from honest reckoning with the choices that people make to harness their professional energies in the service of systems of repression. I'm in fact going to use Justice Jackson's own somewhat ambivalent response to the wartime imprisonment of Japanese Americans to illustrate those very forces. And then at the end, I'm going to take up Justice Jackson's call for deploying education as civilization's last clear chance to avoid the catastrophic mistreatment of minorities. First, my comparison. I'm starting with these two men, comparing them in the winter and spring of 1942, a German and an American, that will strike many of you as tendentious, heavy-handed, maybe even outrageous. By the time my comparison is complete, I hope to have persuaded at least some of you that it is not. It's a comparison of two men who had authority to oversee the forcible removal and exile of a racially defined internal enemy. In one case, the Jews, and in the other case, people of Japanese ancestry. On the left is Benno Martin, and on the right, that's the German. And well, you'll hear why in a second. On the right is Carl Bendtsen, whose name ultimately he claimed as being Danish, although it wasn't. Benno Martin came from a Catholic family in Bavaria that had sent its young men into civil service for hundreds of years. He was a dashing, broad-shouldered man, over 6 feet tall. He joined the Bavarian State Police in 1919. He earned a law degree from Erlangen University in 1923, at which point, at the young age of 30, he was promoted to an administrative position in the political section of the Central Police Office in the city of Nuremberg. He quickly distinguished himself for two things: a law and order agenda and a single-minded focus on his own advancement. Neither of those things was uncomplicated in a city like Nuremberg, which was the home turf of one of the National Socialists' most rabid and unstable anti-Semites, Julius Streicher, and his famous or infamous newspaper, Der Stürmer. Policeman Martin's strategy during that period in the late 1920s was to protect Streicher and his thugs from the SA from prosecution where he could, while simultaneously cultivating a relationship with Adolf Hitler and with Heinrich Himmler, the commander of the SS and an opponent of Streicher's within the National Socialist Party. Benno Martin did not become a member of the party until May 1st, 1933, a few months after Hitler came to power. And this was a moment when there were huge reshufflings of power all across Germany as a result of the accession of Hitler to power. With the support of both Streicher and Himmler, two powerful men who mistrusted each other, Martin was beautifully positioned to capitalize on this reshuffling. And so in late September of 1934, a few months after adding SS membership to his resume, he was appointed the police chief of police for the city of Nuremberg. And he held that position until December of 1942. Now, as an ever-rising star in the Third Reich, Martin might be assumed to have been a National Socialist zealot and a rabid anti-Semite. He appears to have been neither. Through the 1930s, he often used his authority to moderate or deflect the action of the party radicals, and in time to end the power of Julius Streicher in Nuremberg. It's well documented that Martin frequently deployed police power in the 1930s to protect the Jews, or at least some Jews, in Nuremberg from the most extreme degradations that Streicher and his thugs were trying to practice. He warned some Jews in advance of police actions, and he helped some Jews to emigrate. Maybe the shrewdest assessment of Martin came from Reinhard Heydrich, the chief of the Reich's main security office and the later architect of the plan to murder all of the Jews of Europe. In March of 1942, Himmler was considering Benno Martin for a promotion, and Heydrich wrote to Himmler that while Martin's police work in Nuremberg had always been satisfactory at a technical level, it was always in the service of Martin's own personal ends rather than the ends of National Socialism. What Martin was, first and foremost, was ambitious. Whatever Martin's own feelings might have been towards German Jews, when the time came in late 1941 for Heydrich to implement the plan for deporting them all to the east, the task of organizing and implementing that deportation for the region of Franconia fell to Benno Martin. The first deportation came at the end of November of 1941. 1,000 Jews were rousted from their homes, placed on trains, and shipped off to Riga. This was a huge operation with many details to coordinate. A gathering point needed to be found and prepared. Trains needed to be secured. Police personnel needed to be deployed to gather, to register, to search, to guard all of these deportees. Officials needed to be appointed to examine and inventory the property of the deportees. An official planning document dated November 11, 1941, made clear that Martin personally oversaw the overall performance of this deportation. While Martin remained police chief, four more deportations of Franconia's Jews took place on March 24, 1942, April 25th, September 10th, and September 23rd, 1942. In total, about 4,500 Jews were sent eastward, among them my great uncle, Leopold Müller. Fewer than 100 survived, not including my great uncle. In December of 1942, Benno Martin was promoted to a high-ranking position in the SS, Höher SS und Polizeiführer, higher SS and police leader. Carl Benditson, the American, grew up in Aberdeen, Washington, a gritty coastal mill town, birthplace of Kurt Cobain, I might note, although nobody knew that at the time. All of Benditson's grandparents were Jewish immigrants from Lithuania and Poland. He attended Stanford University, Stanford Law School, and then returned to Aberdeen to practice law. Later in life, he would say that he had known many, many Japanese, and Aberdeen was, in fact, home to a small community of about 80 Japanese people of Japanese ancestry, but there's no evidence that Benditson had any intimate involvement with that small Japanese-American community, or, for that matter, that he had views on the Japanese that were different from what one would expect for that time and place. He entered active duty in the United States Army at the rank of captain in 1940. In early July of 1941, the Army reestablished the office of the Provost Marshal General with Major General Alan Gullion at the helm, and Gullion took Benditson in as his assistant. So the young Army lawyer, suddenly promoted to the rank of Major, was all of 33 years old. Major Benditson's involvement in the mass removal of Japanese and Japanese Americans after Pearl Harbor came in two distinct stages. The first stage lasted from December of 1941 through mid-February of 42. Benditson functioned as a kind of intermediary within the military among the various units that were developing the policy of removing en masse all of the people of Japanese ancestry from the West Coast. The second stage began in mid-February of 1942 and lasted through the early summer, with Benditson, buoyed by yet another promotion, stepping into the role of the War Department's factotum for the implementation of the removal policy. A little bit more about this first stage. Here, Benditson was helping his bosses, Gullion, and the commanding general of the Western Defense Command, Lieutenant General John DeWitt, steer government policy toward mass removal of all Japanese and Japanese Americans over the objections of Justice Department officials who thought that the program was unnecessary and illegal. The policy that he was fighting for was unquestionably racial. In an early February 1942 memorandum on what he called the Japanese problem, sound familiar? Benditson wrote that the vast majority of those who have studied the Oriental mind assert that a substantial majority of the US citizens of Japanese ancestry bear allegiance to Japan and will be engaging in organized sabotage if a raid happens along the West Coast. A few days later, In a memorandum that he wrote justifying the decision to remove everyone of Japanese ancestry, Benditson argued, quote, "The Japanese race is an enemy race. And while many members of the citizen generation had become Americanized, the racial strains tending toward disloyalty were undiluted in them." Benditson's views prevailed. And on February 19, 1942, Franklin Roosevelt signed the executive order that delegated to General DeWitt the power to declare military zones from which any persons could be excluded. Then came the second stage. Now General DeWitt confronted the massive logistical problem of implementing the program of mass removal of nearly 120,000 people. He turned to the young and ambitious lawyer who had helped bring the program into being. On March 11th, 1942, right around the time that Benno Schmidt in Nuremberg is organizing deportations of Jews, John DeWitt informs Carl Benditson that he is delegating to him the president's power to bring the executive order into effect. And to sweeten the deal, he gives Benditson yet another promotion, this time to the rank of colonel, which Benditson would note decades later made him the youngest in that grade at that time in the entire US Army. Now he shifted from the role of intermediary and draftsman to the role of boss. He threw himself into the task with dizzying energy. The pilot project on March 30, 1942 was at Bainbridge Island near Seattle. With a week's notice, 55 Japanese families consisting of 91 aliens and 180 American citizens were placed on a ferry to Seattle and then shifted to a train for a long ride to a new confinement facility in California called Manzanar. The Bainbridge Island deportation served as a template for the process that Benditson repeatedly oversaw in the following weeks and months up and down the West Coast. The logistics were overwhelming. Benditson and his staff were responsible for dividing the coast into exclusion zones, notifying and registering the affected population, arranging for transportation, coordinating efforts at dealing with property, selecting and building confinement sites, and hundreds of other tasks, major and minor. In November of 1942, as Nuremberg Police Chief Benno Martin was preparing for his promotion into the higher ranks of the SS, the U.S. Army awarded Carl Benditson its Distinguished Service Medal on the recommendations of Gullion and DeWitt. There is more to these stories that I have yet to tell. I have not said anything yet about the post-war reckoning or lack thereof for these two men. But before comparing that post-war period, I'd like to stop for a minute and clarify the comparison that I'm drawing. Some of you, I suspect, might object to any comparison of American and Nazi policies because American policy was not genocidal. Some of you might see the idea of comparing Carl Benditson with Benno Martin as an exercise in presentism, an unfair imposition on Benditson of the moral sense of our generation. But as it happens, comparing American and Nazi policy is no anachronism. It's something that occurred to people of Benditson's and Martin's own era. To take one example, in 1943, in the Hirabayashi case, which John mentioned, involving a challenge to the constitutionality of the racial curfew that Carl Benditson imposed through John DeWitt in 1942, Frank Murphy, filing a concurring opinion, said that the curfew law, quote, bore a melancholy resemblance to the treatment accorded to members of the Jewish race in Germany and in other parts of Europe. That's in 1943. What's more, the comparison of American and German deportations occurred to Benno Martin early in the 1950s as he defended himself in a German domestic court against criminal charges arising from the deportation of Franconia's Jews. His lawyer sought to normalize the German policy, contextualize it, by comparing it to the contemporaneous American program. He argued pure evacuation measures were carried out neither solely against Jews nor solely by Germans. This is from a brief. In fact, on behalf of Martin, in fact, the American General DeWitt, as High Commander of the American West Coast, gathered 112,000 American citizens of Japanese ancestry living on the West Coast in camps in the country's interior after the start of the war with Japan. The German court wasn't persuaded by the analogy, but the point here is that the idea of seeing commonality in the two countries' deportation processes is not only not unfairly presentist, it's not presentist at all. Now, some might object to comparing Benditson and Martin on the basis that the contexts of the two deportations were different. Jews posed no threat to German security, while the Japanese did pose such a threat to and in the United States. This objection is mistaken for at least two reasons. For one, even if Japan posed enough of a military threat to the mainland in early 42 to support mass action against a domestic enemy, Carl Benditson's program didn't distinguish between Japanese aliens and American citizens. The only thing that connected US citizens to the Japanese military enemy was a belief in the idea of a racially defined enemy of the state, which is a notion with a German pedigree as well. Second, this objection fails to recognize that in Nazi ideology, Jews absolutely did pose a threat to German security. As the Nazis saw things, Jews were responsible for the stab in the back that undid Germany in World War I and led to the punitive Versailles Treaty. Jews were the core of Bolshevism, National Socialism's nemesis. Jews were responsible for the hyperinflation that beset Germany in the Weimar years. And young Jewish men assassinated Nazi officials or plotted violence against Nazi offices in several different episodes in the 1930s. To suggest that Americans rightly worried about Americans of Japanese ancestry while Germans arbitrarily victimized Jews is to misunderstand both the American and the German frame of mind. Some might recoil from comparing Bendtsen to Martin on the basis that while Bendtsen was a cog in the machinery of exclusion and confinement, Martin was a cog in the exponentially more immoral machinery of mass murder. This observation absolutely distinguishes the two systems, but it does not meaningfully distinguish the two men. Nothing in the historical record suggests that Benno Martin knew that the deportations he was arranging were a prelude to mass murder. Martin was an important regional police chief, but he was not party to the planning that was taking place above his head at the level of a Heinrich Himmler or a Reinhard Heydrich to turn the object of the Nazi program for the Jews from forced emigration to physical annihilation. He had no seat at the table at the famous or infamous Wannsee Conference in 1942, January, where a range of upper-level bureaucrats acceded to Heydrich's control over the program of industrialized genocide. His work in Nuremberg in late 41 and early 42 would have given him no word of the gas chambers and crematoria that were just under construction at that point at Belzec, Sobibor, and Treblinka. What Benno Martin had to account for was designing and overseeing a system that forced people defined as a racial enemy out of their communities and into indefinite exile as vulnerable wards of the state. That is also what Carl Bendtsen did. And yet, in the face of this, some of you will undoubtedly continue to recoil from comparing the American and German deportation planners. There is an undeniable sense in the American popular mind that anything in the story of Nazi Germany is of a different order from everything in the American experience. To some extent, this may derive from the continued sway in the American imagination of a monolithic image of Nazi Germany that scholars long ago discredited, one in which Germany was a crushingly hierarchical terror state bent on genocide from the moment the Nazis came to power. Americans' refusal to contemplate Germany's racial deportations as an analog to America's also may reflect an offshoot of a broader American exceptionalism, an emotional commitment to the idea that whereas other countries' impositions on minorities are deplorable, ours are debatable. Justice Jackson may have betrayed some of that American discomfort with reckoning when he returned to Buffalo for his 1951 speech. And I will return to that question in a moment after briefly describing the post-war processes of reckoning for these two men. At the end of the war, Benno Martin was captured by Allied forces and imprisoned. He was not among the high-level perpetrators deemed appropriate for prosecution at Nuremberg, so he was transferred to German custody in 1948 for trial in German domestic courts. In 1949, the state prosecutor charged him with the crime of aiding and abetting a state official's deprivation of liberty, resulting in death. This triggered a four-year odyssey of trials, appellate reversals, acquittals, state appeals, more acquittals, and finally, an ultimate acquittal in a German appellate court. That's right, Benno Martin walked free, acquitted on the weakest and most implausible of his grounds of defense, namely that while he was a friend of the Jews, who often used his discretion to help Jews out, he ordered the deportations under duress, afraid that he would be sent to a concentration camp himself if he didn't simply follow orders. While Benno Martin was facing his first trial in Germany in 1949, Carl Bendelsohn was doing quite well. He left the army in December of 45, joined a management consulting firm in California, then came back to Washington in 1948 to serve as a special assistant to the defense secretary. In 1949, he organized the Office of General Counsel to the US Army, and he was the first to serve in that position. Army Secretary Gordon Gray then made known that he wanted to appoint Bendelsohn to be Assistant Secretary of the Army. And this was the first moment when Bendelsohn's past began to dog him, at least a little bit. The National Democratic Party geared up to oppose the nomination, the Japanese American Citizens League did the same, and then the situation grew rather uncomfortable for him when a critical letter appeared in the press written by a Catholic priest in Los Angeles who recalled that when Bendelsohn was overseeing the removal of Japanese Americans from Los Angeles, he had, in the priest's words, shown himself to be a little Hitler who decreed that orphans had to be evicted even if, in Bendelsohn's words, they have just one drop of Japanese blood in them. Bendelsohn privately admitted to the Secretary of the Army that he was suffering an unhappy and frustrating experience. But in the end, these protests came to nothing, and Bendelsohn won approval from the Senate in February of 1950. He was 42 years old. Oops. 2 years later, Bendelsohn's rise continued. When the Undersecretary of the Army resigned to pursue political office, President Truman nominated Carl Bendelsohn to take his place. Confirmation was swift and uncontested. The Senate confirmed him in early May of 1952. At age 44, he came to occupy the second highest civilian position in the US Army. And this is his swearing-in ceremony. He left the position in late 1952 to go into private industry, became vice president, general manager of a huge paper and wood product company, and became the chief executive officer in the mid-60s, and retired a very wealthy man in 1972. By the 1980s, the public's understanding of the incarceration of Japanese Americans had begun to shift. Congress launched an investigation. That investigation included hearings. Carl Bendelsohn, by then fairly elderly, testified at those hearings in the 1980s, and he testified unapologetically defending his actions during the war. He was booed and jeered by Japanese Americans in the audience, but he never lived to appreciate much more of the tarnishing of his reputation. He slipped into the clutches of Alzheimer's disease in the mid-1980s and died in 1989 at the age of 1981 and was buried with honor in Arlington National Cemetery. Speaking here in 1946, Justice Jackson predicted that the Nuremberg trials would unleash a wave of education, a wave of educative reckoning, and cement the role of the law in restraining what Jackson called the psychology of war. But the 5 years between the 1946 speech and the 1951 speech saw very little of that reckoning. If you look carefully at Justice Jackson's 1951 speech, you can see some hint of why that might be. He started off where he had ended in 1946. He reminded his listeners that the rule of law was the only thing strong enough to protect the liberties of citizens. But he quickly set the American experience in World War II apart from that of every other combatant. Unlike other nations, said Justice Jackson here in 51, we came through the war without serious impairment of our system of ordered liberty under law. Now, it should go without saying that the tens of thousands of US citizens forced from their homes and confined for years on account of their Japanese ancestry might have quibbled with Justice Jackson's definition of a serious impairment. Later in his 1951 address, he turned directly to the Japanese-American wartime experience, and he recalled his dissenting opinion in Korematsu versus United States. He didn't, in 1951, equivocate on his views about the removal and internment of Japanese-Americans. It seemed to me then, he said here in 1951, and it does now, that the measure was unconstitutional. Now, a judge wishing to apply the lessons of Nuremberg to demonstrate the supremacy of law over such catastrophic and lawless forces as war and persecutions, as he put it here in 1946, might have been expected to vote to invalidate the measure. That is just what Associate Justices Frank Murphy and Owen Roberts did in their dissents in Korematsu, but Justice Jackson did not join them. He instead reasoned that because the courts were incompetent to evaluate the merits of the government's claims of military necessity, they should decline to reach the issue of the measure's legality and instead declare the issue inappropriate for a civilian court to adjudicate. What a stunning position for an advocate of the rule of law as a restraint on wartime excess. In his speech here, he admitted a touch of discomfort with his position, but in the Korematsu dissent itself, he took comfort from his expectation that the judgments of American military leaders would be restrained by the will of the people. He said, "The chief restraint on those who command the physical forces of this country, in the future as in the past, must be their responsibility to the political judgments of their contemporaries and to the moral judgments of history." How odd. For the rest of the world, Justice Jackson preached the rule of law as an agent of reckoning. For the United States, Justice Jackson was prepared to trust these tasks to politics. And that's the curious blind spot in Justice Jackson's otherwise extremely admirable vision. Experience had proven him wrong. Politics had not been up to the task of preventing the mass racial exile and incarceration of Japanese Americans in 1942. Worries about the moral judgments of history had not been big enough to stop military officials in their tracks. And even as Justice Jackson spoke here, the American architect of exile and incarceration, Carl Bendetson, continued on his youthful, meteoric rise to the top echelon of the army. What Justice Jackson presented was a form of American exceptionalism. But there's little reason to think that hesitating to condemn wrongdoers with the force of law is a uniquely American instinct. Remember that the courts of West Germany exonerated Benno Martin for deporting the Jews of Nuremberg. And that was no isolated case. Between 1950 and 1962, the West Germans investigated 30,000 former Nazis, indicted about 13,000, tried about 5,500, and acquitted over 4,000. That is an acquittal rate of 75%. The perpetrators whose convictions were struck down were mostly, the ones whose convictions stuck, were mostly low-ranking thugs with blood on their hands. The mid and upper-level functionaries who set up and ran the machinery of repression from their desks were most often exonerated. At this rather bleak moment, it would be useful to recall Justice Jackson's promise in 1946, his opening argument that improvement through education offers the last clear chance of civilization to avoid catastrophe. In a world where psychological and political forces and the passage of time naturally tend to shift our attention away from attributing responsibility for the excess of war, can education help to counteract those forces? Can education strengthen our resolve to demonstrate the supremacy of law over the persecutions of wartime? I answer that question affirmatively, but I answer it a little bit differently from Justice Jackson. I answer it by pointing to the careers of Benno Martin and Carl Bendetson. Most people, I think, have a hard time seeing much of themselves in a monster like Hermann Göring, convicted at Nuremberg. Condemning him is morally essential, but not particularly morally instructive. Studying the lives of Carl Bendetson and Benno Martin is a different matter. Neither of these men, trained in the law, appears to have been a particularly extreme racist for his time. Neither stood at the pinnacle of governing power. Both men were public servants, toiling at the upper levels of their respective bureaucracies. Each of them was able to tell himself a plausible story about how much worse things would have been if a more unscrupulous person had held his office. And yet each set in motion the mass uprooting and physical isolation of a vulnerable population. What links the professional lives of these two lawyers is not virulent racism, and it is not extreme bloodthirstiness. It is the warping influence of bureaucratic ambition. These were two breathtakingly striving men. Although it's uncomfortable to defer to the character assessments of a criminal like Reinhard Heydrich, his assessment of Benno Martin seems spot on. What guided Benno Martin was most of all a desire to climb in rank and prestige. Sometimes Nazi racial policies were stepping stones, sometimes they were stumbling stones around which he had to pick a path. But the path was the thing, and he trod it in the space of a decade from the middling ranks of a city police force all the way up to the higher SS and police leader for his entire region. Same kind of thing is true for Carl Bendtsen. In a far shorter time than Martin managed his ascent, Bendtsen rose from captain to major to colonel, serving in these latter positions, as he liked to brag, as the youngest man in his rank. Within 6 months after the US entered the war, Bendtsen sat atop a War Department unit of his own creation, asserting near complete authority over civilians across a huge swath of the country. And there can be no question that the springboard to all of this was Bendtsen's own ambition, his willingness to harness his lawyerly energies to a policy of racial isolation and control that he knew the country's top civilian lawyers and security officials thought was unnecessary and illegal. The very last thing in the paper that I've contributed to this event is some musings about how legal education might specifically take this example of these two men and instantiate it as a way of providing a moral anchor to weigh against this pull of ambition that we all, as human beings, can often feel, particularly in office settings. But time is short, and I've spoken long enough, so I will leave you there and pass things along to my friend Mary Dujek.
I'm so honored to be here at Buffalo, long known as a mecca for legal history. I'd like to echo the thanks, in the interest of time, just quickly, the thanks that my good friends and fabulous speakers and scholars, John Barrett and Eric Mueller, have given. And I'd also like to say that Dean Macau, you should be very proud of your students. Because I don't think I've ever been to an event anywhere so well attended by law students where there is no free food. So thank you all for being here and for staying with me to the end. And I apologize, I'm going to have to speak quickly and literally run for the airport. When Robert Jackson came to Buffalo 65 years ago, he stood on the threshold of a new era. In his centennial speech, Jackson took account of a war era the world was just emerging from. The horrors of World War II, he hoped, reshaped the world in a way that would lessen such devastating conflict and destruction. Until this time, collective efforts had not been able to hold back war. But Nuremberg changed this, he hoped. Its long-range significance, he argued, lay in the effort to demonstrate or to establish the supremacy of law over such lawless and catastrophic forces as war and persecutions. From Nuremberg might come legal controls of these disastrous forces, but only the coming years would show whether the efforts at Nuremberg were, he said, but a flash of light in an otherwise dark century, or the harbinger of a dawn. Even as he urged that human action through law could hold back the forces of warfare, Jackson warned of a different future. If the East and West cannot or will not bridge the gaps in interest and method and political viewpoint now evident and so often over-dramatized. It may be that the good efforts of this drawing together in jurisprudential principles and procedures, sorry, that's the wrong slide, will be dissipated. He found it difficult to believe that we will not be able to live together without sacrificing either peace or fundamental interests. My task is to set Justice Jackson in the world he occupied when he returned from Nuremberg, and to try to follow him as that world fell apart. I mean, not personally, but the way the world as it exists in terms of the state of peace and war sort of fell apart. If war or security affected American law, then we need to think about what was that war or security, and how did it come into domestic lawmaking? When legal scholars write about the impact of war on law, they often look very closely at the law part of it, but take war as a given. They cite each other about what the contours of the war was and how long it lasted, as opposed to, for example, looking to diplomatic history and military history and really sort of interrogating the nature of war. So as with any law and society problem, if we want to understand the impact of social issues on law, we need to look at both sides of the equation. So we need to look seriously at the nature of war and security when we think about how it might have filtered in and affected American law. So there, a set of ideas about war and peace were held by the World War II generation. Wartime and peacetime were more or less distinct states. People could tell when they were in a wartime. After all, Congress would declare it. Imagine that. Wartime was followed by peacetime, and this meant that wars were, by definition, temporary. Rights were sometimes compromised in wartime. You've heard the little swinging pendulum story. And presidents sometimes overstepped the limits of their power. But since war times were temporary, this would all eventually go away. The basic structure to thinking about wartime still lurks in American jurisprudence, even in the age of drone warfare, when apparently it's not a war if only the other people get hurt. But there was a moment when this way of thinking seemed to collapse, when the concept of peacetime dissolved, leading instead, as Justice Jackson put it, a prolonged period of international tension and rumors of war, when war itself, with war itself as ever-threatening alternative. This is how Jackson viewed the world when he returned to Buffalo to deliver the inaugural Mitchell Lecture in 1951. Let's think about the way history unfolded and whether Jackson's vision of peace through law and legal institutions could survive in an era that came to be called the Cold War. Before the Nuremberg Tribunal heard its first witness, writers on both sides of the Atlantic around the world took stock of a world reshaped by the advent of nuclear weapons. In the fall of 1945, George Orwell wrote that the bomb was likely to change the structure of global politics. Weak states would become weaker, and two or three monstrous superstates, each with nuclear weapons, would divide the world between them. These monster states would not use the bomb against each other. Instead, each state might be in an unconquerable, permanent state of Cold War with its neighbors. The nuclear age would be, therefore, a Cold War era in which the world would see an end to large-scale wars at the cost of prolonging indefinitely a peace that is no peace. The idea of a Cold War was, of course, intentionally contradictory, suggesting an era of war but not war. It was a time of deep anxiety in American culture, and nothing captured this more clearly than the doomsday clock. first called the Clock of Doom when it appeared in June 1947. The clock measured movement toward a nuclear apocalypse. It was intended to represent the state of mind of nuclear scientists, but soon became a ubiquitous symbol of nuclear danger. In 1953, after both the United States and Soviet Union tested powerful thermonuclear bombs, the hands of the clock moved to 2 minutes to midnight so that, in the words of bulletin editor Eugene Rabinowitz, only a few more swings of the pendulum and atomic explosions will strike midnight for Western civilization. Underlying the anxiety of Cold War thought was the idea that once nuclear weapons had come into existence, nuclear war was inevitable. In March 1946, while the Nuremberg trial was in session, Winston Churchill warned that an iron curtain had descended across the continent of Europe. This was a solemn moment as the United States, at the pinnacle of world power, shouldered awe-inspiring accountability to the future. For Churchill, Soviet power and aggression could not be reined in by international law. They could only be met with American strength and solidarity with Western Europe. The anxieties of the nuclear age were manifested in post-World War II national security politics. Historian Michael Hogan argues that Cold War struggles over American policy and the nature of the state were about more than combating communism. Also at stake was American national security, national identity, the nation's role in the world, and the impact of the Cold War on domestic institutions. After World War II, Americans hoped for a return to peacetime concerns. Initially, American leaders divided in their perceptions of the world conditions they confronted. In battles over the budget and military policy, some policymakers viewed the idea of distinctions between war and peace to be a technicality outmoded in the new era, when the United States needed to be prepared for war on a permanent basis. The central challenge of state-making in the early Cold War, Hogan argues, was to prepare for a permanent struggle without surrendering constitutional principles and democratic traditions to the garrison state. President Truman initially tried to maintain the idea of a peacetime world and insisting that his policies were not mobilization for war, but were preparedness. But Truman himself encouraged war hysteria to generate support for foreign aid to Greece and Turkey in his Truman Doctrine speech in March 1947. Framing the Cold War as an epic struggle, Truman warned that at the present moment in world history, nearly every nation must choose between alternative ways of life. The choice was too often not a free one. Truman contrasted between a way of life based upon the will of the majority, distinguished by free institutions, etc., and a second way of life relying on terror, oppression, a controlled press, radio, and fixed elections, and suppression of personal freedom. To safeguard American liberty, Truman insisted that the United States must provide the free peoples who were resisting communism around the world with support. So the Truman Doctrine was about the projection of American power, not about maintaining peace through international institutions. The following year would seem darker with a coup in Czechoslovakia, the Berlin blockade of West Berlin by the Soviets, with the goal of American, French, and British troops being driven from the city. And this is a picture of the Berlin airlift. In response to increasing global tensions in a bipolar world, the idea was to project American power. If international law might restrain aggression, it was at least a distant second to power, economic and military. In August 1949, the Soviet Union exploded its first bomb. This was also the time of the fall of China to the communists. And then in June 1950, North Korea invades South Korea. Events seemed to propel the world closer to the brink, and American leaders crafted a Cold War strategy premised on the idea that projecting American military power around the world was the best means of safeguarding American security. NSC 68, this important report, would remain secret during Jackson's lifetime, but became central to American national security policy. At home, Cold War anxieties filtered into domestic politics. So in February 1950, Senator Joe McCarthy, he was looking for a campaign issue. Someone else had taken up crime to control, so he turned to anti-communism, and that February falsely claimed that he had in his hand a list of 205 communists employed in the State Department. He would not be alone in running for office on red baiting. Meanwhile, Hogan writes, national security became a common currency of policymakers, the arbiter of most values, the key to America's identity. In American national security ideology, the distinction between war and peace had disappeared as the government transitioned to a national security state. These global tensions troubled Robert Jackson as he resumed his role as a Supreme Court justice, and they challenged his vision to peace through law. In the spring of 1947, the specter of imminent war did not worry him, but instead the spread of totalitarianism, which he said left the world more fear-ridden than it was at the close of a war to give freedom from fear. Jackson's most memorable opinion on individual rights and war had been West Virginia Board of Education versus Barnett in 1943. And that was the case where the court struck down a mandatory flag salute requirement so that these children had been expelled from school for refusing to salute this flag for religious reasons. And then in one of his soaring opinions, Jackson wrote, struggles to coerce uniformity of sentiment in support of some end thought to be essential to their time and country had been waged by many good as well as evil men. But the ultimate futility of efforts to compel coherence is the lesson of every such effort, from the Roman drive to stamp out Christianity as the disturber of pagan unity, mentions other examples, down to the fast-failing efforts of our present totalitarian enemies. Those who begin coercive elimination of dissent soon find themselves exterminating dissenters. So if the rights of Jehovah's Witnesses appealed to Jackson's constitutional sympathies, Cold War-era radicals certainly did not. He sided with the majority in the prosecution of the of Communist Party members in Dennis versus United States. They were prosecuted not for concrete actions geared toward overthrowing the government, but for teaching and advocating radical ideas. Now, interestingly, in this and other cases, Jackson didn't apply the court's prevailing First Amendment doctrine to the defendants in the Dennis case. That would be the normal thing to do. You think they're dangerous, you apply a clear and present danger test, and you find that notwithstanding a First Amendment rights, that the government can nevertheless prosecute them. Instead, Jackson devotes much of his concurrence in that case to a description of the methods of communists, drawing lessons from recent experience, including the coup in Czechoslovakia, where he says that basically in other countries, communists had risen to power in part through taking advantage of, for example, free speech rights. The clear and present danger test in the First Amendment, Jackson said, had been developed for a different era. When the issue of criminality of a hot-headed speech on a street corner, or circulation of a few incendiary pamphlets, or refusal of a handful of children to salute the flag, when that's what's going on, it is not beyond the capacity of the judicial process to gather, comprehend, and weigh the necessary materials for decision whether it is a clear and present danger of substantive evil or a harmless letting off of steam. But this doctrine should not apply to communists, he argued, a well-organized nationwide conspiracy, unless we are to hold our government captive in a judge-made trap. In rejecting the claims of the Dennis defendants, he placed most of his attention on facts not in evidence, but on what he knew or what he believed about communism in the world. In the flag salute case, protecting rights safeguarded democracy. In Dennis, rights seemed to threaten democracy. In arguing that the security threat counseled departure from the court's otherwise applicable doctrine, Jackson's argument was triggered by his assessment of the threat, by a national security judgment, the sort of calculus courts are usually reluctant to engage in. Jackson's attention to the nature of communism was also important as his concurrence and dissent in American Communications Association versus Dowd, a case that upheld a requirement that that union officers had to sign an anti-communist affidavit before their union could take advantage of labor law protections. He said, the Congress could regularly have concluded that the Communist Party is something different in fact from any other substantial party we have known, and hence may constitutionally be treated as something different in law. Again, existing principles simply had to be cast aside for this dangerous group. Jackson's analysis in this opinion was so resonant that it was reprinted in the New York Times Magazine. In these opinions, we don't see the idea of a swinging pendulum, swinging from rights toward security during wartime. Instead, we see one group, communists, outside the community entitled to law's protection. Jackson's views about communism would carry through even to cases that had significant human rights implications, particularly Herodiades versus Shaughnessy in 1952, when Jackson wrote the majority opinion upholding the deportation of three resident aliens who arrived in the United States as children and then later joined the Communist Party. So they were being deported for their later party membership. His analysis was not driven by the idea that the Cold War was a wartime. The power to deport was greater in war, he noted, but congressional apprehension of foreign or internal dangers short of war may lead to its use. But war-ish metaphors informed his opinion. The Due Process Clause, this is resonant with one of this Holmes' opinion, where he basically said, in Buck versus Bell, where he basically acknowledges that the best citizens give out their lives for the country, so we shouldn't be troubled by, you know, folks like woman considered to be mentally retarded, who was then compulsorily sterilized, that these lesser burdens placed on others when the best citizens give their lives for the country. Jackson said the Due Process Clause did not shield the citizen from conscription and the consequent calamity of being separated from family, friends, home, and business while he is transported to foreign lands to stem the tide of communism. If communist aggression creates such hardships for loyal citizens, it is hard to find justification for holding that the Constitution requires that its hardships must be spared the communist alien. So somehow this quasi-war had made communists a quasi-enemy. Jackson's human rights vision had been crafted in an era when many European Jews became stateless in their flight from the Holocaust. So Jackson was attuned to the great human impact of the deportation power. Still, he wrote, we think that in the present state of the world, it would be rash and irresponsible to reinterpret our fundamental law to deny or qualify the government's power of deportation. For Jackson, rights in these cases turned not on whether the nation was in wartime or peacetime, but on the nature of the threat. He argued that the political branches were better at judging the proper response to national security problems, but nevertheless, he rested his opinions on his own national security analysis. What of the war powers? And Jackson, we get to end on an upbeat note, I promise. What of the war powers and Jackson's tremendously influential analysis in the steel seizure case? that 1952 case in which the court struck down Truman's effort to seize a steel mill to avert a strike is remembered by constitutional scholars as a case about presidential power during wartime, one of the few cases when the court said to the president, you can't use this war power in this way during wartime. And so we might be able to brush the ambiguities of the Cold War era aside, since the case deals squarely with Truman's ability to seize steel mills during the Korean War when steel was necessary for production of war materiel. Jackson's concurrence famously categorizes the scope of presidential power based on whether or not the president is acting pursuant to or against authorization from Congress. And what I want to do right now is talk about the parts of the opinion that don't end up in your casebook, that actually now are more resonant than ever. Jackson remarks, so it's not wartime that's driving his analysis, concurring in the majority opinion denying Truman this power. Jackson remarks on the slipperiness of the categories. Loose and irresponsible use of adjectives colors all non-legal and much legal discussion of presidential powers. Inherent power, implied power, incidental power, plenary power, war power, emergency power are used often interchangeably without fixed or ascertainable meanings. And he warns that a president cannot have the power to define, he warns that the president cannot have the power to define an era as a war, thereby triggering his own war powers. Jackson didn't find it necessary or appropriate to decide was the Korean War a war. He called it the Korean Enterprise. He wouldn't give to Truman, he wouldn't say, call it a war. At one point he says, he says, well, it's not a de jure war, maybe it's a de facto war. But Congress, he said, retained the power to declare war, and they had not used it here. In Korea, the president had acted without Congress, thereby seeming to invest himself with the war powers. No doctrine the court could promulgate would seem to me more sinister and alarming, Jackson wrote, than that a president whose conduct of foreign affairs is so largely uncontrolled and often even unknown can vastly enlarge his mastery over the internal affairs of the country by his own commitment of the nation's armed forces to some foreign venture. Jackson himself had argued that President Roosevelt could draw upon the Commander-in-Chief powers long before Congress declared war in World War II. Here, he says, the court should, he's distinguishing his efforts from the steel seizure. The court should not limit the president's war, the kind of powers FDR had used before World War II, and the war powers deserve the widest latitude, he said, at least when turned against the outside world for the security of our society. It was the internal use of these powers that troubled Jackson. We do not have a militaristic system, he argued, but a constitutional republic. The purpose of placing the presidency and the commander-in-chief in one person was to ensure that the civilian would control the military, not to enable the military to subordinate the presidential office. No penance would ever expiate the sin against free government of holding that a president can escape control of executive powers by law through assuming his military role. The reliance on emergency power by European governments during World War II, he said, showed emergency powers are consistent with free government only when control is lodged elsewhere than in the executive who exercises them. So if Jackson's anti-communist opinions seem to tied to the fears of his era, it is the steel seizure concurrence that helps us to look forward. His most important critique, As influential as his tripartite analysis of presidential power is, I think looking back for us now, his most important critique was that the president had himself declared an era a wartime and then argued that this self-declared wartime was the occasion for the expansion of his own powers. Korea, he said, was a foreign venture. And when it came to the powers of war, in our system of government, those powers have to be reined in by law. So we can see from the steel seizure case, this problem existed long before a president would declare war on terrorism. And don't worry, in the book, I go after President Obama too, remember the drone. But we can, the presidents themselves announce a wartime, commit American troops, and thereby create the occasion for the invocation of their own powers. When Robert Jackson returned to Buffalo to deliver the first Mitchell lecture on May 9, 1951, he spoke of an altered world than he had imagined in 1946 when he gave that other lecture. This time his topic was wartime security and liberty under law, but his title belied the ambiguity of the era. His lecture drew from his opinions of the previous few years, when he often described the era in such fluid terms. Jackson had once thought of 1946 as an ending to warfare, but this new era had not brought a peacetime. Instead, he told the audience at Buffalo, "The best that we can see now, best what we can now hope for, seems to be a prolonged period of international tension and rumors of war, with war itself as the ever-threatening alternative. In this environment, we can never take liberty or security for granted." And let me just skip ahead because I do have to run to the airport. But I think that we, the way he described his world in those post-Nuremberg years, he says in 1954, the last year of his life, Americans were troubled, disillusioned, and confused. And I think sometimes of the way he thought about his world as being so much more similar to the world that we have been occupying, where we don't see these finite lines between war and peace. We see this sort of hovering threat of security. It's hard to define it and pin it down. But what we also see is presidents defining the age, presidents going it alone, sometimes getting Congress along with them. What we don't see is the American people playing a role in a politics of war. We don't, I think, have a check on executive power to basically call it a war, call in the troops, and then draw upon the then self-generated war power. Unless we have the American people essentially checking back in, being told not to go shopping, being encouraged to participate in the military action done in their name, and that we therefore ultimately bear responsibility for. In Jackson's steel seizure opinion, he's in this era when his vision of holding back power through law, holding back warfare through law, seemed not to hold. And what he's left with, I think, is simply a faith. You know, a faith that somehow, in some way, legal institutions can do something. That the people, through legal institutions, can do something. The national security state is developing underneath him. Right, but he believes that political action, collective action through law, that it's not all determined from there, right? That a politics and a use of law can hold back the forces of warfare. He says at the end of his steel seizure opinion, with all its defects, delays, and inconveniences, humans have discovered no technique for long preserving free government except that the executive be under the law, and that the law be made by parliamentary deliberations. And we might build into that informed by a politics where the people are actually involved. Such institutions may be destined to pass away, he said, but it is the duty of the court, and I would say it was the duty of all of us here, to be the last, not to first, the first to give it up. So thank you so much, and I'm so sorry I can't stay for questions.
On behalf of the University at Buffalo, I'd like to thank our distinguished panelists for their consummately researched, provocative, and challenging lectures that they've given us today, each of which shows why they are known as three of the most prominent legal historians in the United States. Each of them has addressed Justice Jackson's Centennial lecture, a timeless speech that, as has we've seen, raises issues of major contemporary significance, including how we respond to global human rights abuse, aggressive war, war in general, our role as teachers, students, interpreters, and appliers of the law, and the role that the rule of law plays in preventing abusive and aggressive conduct. Our speakers have, in this sense, addressed not only the historical context of Justice Jackson's address, but its enduring lessons and implications, which include its potential blind spots, amnesias, and exceptionalist understandings. Professor John Barrett has traced the two paths back to Buffalo of Justice Jackson and enumerated the eight major themes in Justice Jackson's address. Professor Eric Muller has drawn provocatively on Justice Jackson's call for a greater role for legal ethics in American legal education, what Jackson called the last clear chance of civilization to avoid catastrophe. Professor Muller has thus challenged us to think critically about what we do as lawyers, why, and how lawyers are trained, including how they often contribute to war, aggression, and human rights abuse. Professor Dudziak has addressed how war has become regularized and ongoing, no longer an exceptional event, and what the consequences are for justifying extreme actions, including for those like torture and detention without trial. In so doing, she has recalled Justice Jackson's 1946 admonition on how a warlike spirit can overcome a nation with breathtaking consequences for the rule of law, human rights, liberty, and freedom. Justice Jackson closed his 1946 speech by saying it will take time to learn the ultimate effect of the Nuremberg trial on international law and to what extent it may deter attacks on the peace of the world and persecutions of minorities. We have made a great deal of progress in this regard, but as our Mitchell lectures have made clear, we still have a long way to go. We invite continued discussion of these critically important issues as we bring this Mitchell lecture to a close. We have, of course, passed over our time, but I hope to invite you all to stay for an additional 15 minutes for any questions or comments that you'd like to make about the Mitchell lectures. And I would invite those who would like to have comments to proceed down to the microphones on either side of the auditorium and to keep your questions or comments brief. Thank you very much again to our Mitchell lecturers.
Do you think that Justice Jackson recognized that maybe Nuremberg was more of a political show, but in order to create an environment where the rule of law could be used at a future point in time to deter war, he went along with it anyway?
In part, I would say. Nuremberg certainly had teaching functions, and Jackson was aware of the public relations dimension and had good advice and insisted on a public trial and transcripts and daily reportage and so forth. But I think it wasn't a show. People were acquitted and walked out of that courtroom as free men, which frustrated him as a prosecutor, but he'd done his part in an adversary system to an independent bench which had walked those defendants. So I think the way to view it is really against a show trial model, which was well known by that point in time and something that the Soviets believed the Allied leaders had committed to and that Nuremberg should be, and Jackson's commitment, if he was to be part of it, was to a real trial.
Jackson
No, it was 7 years after his death.
Yes, Bendetson was born Jewish and was practiced as a Jew as a child and teenager, but then converted and actually changed the spelling of his last name to make it look more Danish, and then actually created a whole fictional Danish ancestry for himself.
Hi. My question doesn't have very much to do with Justice Jackson, but it's something that I'm very much interested in, and I would like to address this to Eric Mueller. I don't know very much about Benno Martin, but I'm interested in him. And I didn't know until today that he'd gone to the University of Erlangen. Is that correct?
Yes, it is.
Okay. Erlangen was a refuge for Huguenots. And I'd like to give you a little background on the Huguenots to refresh your mind. In 1598, there was the Edict of Nantes, which gave religious freedom. 1685, King Louis XIV revoked the Edict of Nantes. Later on, François Mitterrand said that was the worst mistake France ever made. But growing up in a town that had been a refuge for people who had fled there for religious freedom, did that not make any impression on Benno Martin?
Well, I don't know the full answer to that. The thing that I would say is that, just factually, Benno Martin actually grew up in Kaiserslautern. He simply attended university got his law degree from Erlangen. So he had not grown up in Erlangen. He went there as a young man. Beyond that, I really can't. I have no evidence to say anything at all about what his presence at Erlangen might have signified for him, or what he might have learned there, except perhaps to note that his SS records make clear that he continued to identify himself as a believer in God throughout the 1930s and 1940s, which was perhaps one of the few things in his record that is inconsistent with the idea of overweening ambition, because it was easier for a person to rise up the ranks in the Nazi Party, setting that aside, than to continue to insist upon identifying as having some religious faith.
A quick question on Youngstown Sheaton 2, the steel seizure case, and to either of you gentlemen, or both if you wish. Certainly the United States participated in the Security Council debate, and since it did not exercise its veto, it could be said that the United States did willingly embark upon a state of war. Is this something that Justice Jackson took account of in his writing on the case itself?
I would say only in the passing phrases that Mary quoted. Of course, the part of the United States at the Security Council is the executive branch. Mm-hmm. And so, yes, non-veto, yes, acquiescence in the United Nations action by the president, in a sense, awarding himself war powers, which is what leads Jackson to use those phrases like enterprise and venture, as opposed to Article I's war power, the declaration power belonging to the Congress.
Professor Mueller, I have a couple questions on the comparison of the evacuation of the Jews from Nuremberg and the internment of the Japanese in the American West. Number one, how many Jewish casualties were there during the evacuation of Nuremberg as compared to the evacuation of the Japanese in California? And number two, with respect to the real property, personal property of the evacuees, what was the game plan in Nuremberg compared to the game plan in the American West?
If the question about the deportations from Nuremberg and Würzburg in late 41 and not early 1942, and how many casualties there would have been during the deportation itself, as opposed to what might have occurred once people disembarked in the East. The answer is that the cases would be comparable, because this was before this was before the so-called final, so the genocidal final solution to the Jewish question, as it was phrased at the time. And these deportations, actually, people did bring luggage with them, and they, in fact, were deported on passenger trains. This was before the horrors of the cattle cars, and which would come later.
Well,
so that's a factual answer to the question that you posed. The second question you asked was about disposition of property, and there's little question that the entire program in Nazi Germany was vastly more rapacious than the system in the United States was.
In other words, the Jews weren't going to get their property back, but the Japanese presumably were intended to return to their homes and their property.
The U.S. government put modest structures in place to assist Japanese Americans in trying to secure their property on the West Coast, with the thought that they would ultimately return. As it happened, those systems in fact broke down, and most Japanese American families lost most everything. But that was in significant measure through private action rather than government dispossession.
You mean the property was looted, or they
yes.
lost titles to the property?
Both. Go for it, John.
It's a very good question. I guess it's always an unfolding answer. So snapshot moment right now. The ICC is an infant institution with all the startup issues and complexities and personnel quality and problems that you allude to. There's no question that it is a logical and structural successor to the International Military Tribunal. That Nuremberg to ICTY, ICTR, ICC chain with a large Cold War gap is direct structurally. And I think that it is striking how much Nuremberg matters to the participants in today's 21st century international tribunals, not just prosecutors, but judges, defense attorneys, and so forth. There's something of a gold standard looking back reflex that they all do have. So in their startup environment, that's one measure of the connection. Beyond that, I guess I would stay tuned.
See you in 60 years.
Right, exactly.
We'll all be back here together 60 years from now, too.
Thanks.
Professor Muller, in law school, I was fortunate to take contract law from Lon Fuller. And he suggested that in the rule of law, if one drew a line graph as a spectrum of intimacy and put families at one end of the graph and countries at the other, that law worked particularly well in the middle, not so well at either end. But suggested that in the middle, as to your point, that ambition and arrogance of power required sort of an unfettered and more engaged populace to respond to those abuses, whether it be Joseph McCarthy or whether it be in the situation you postulated. And I wondered if you had any thoughts about that in terms of incumbency and political life, in terms of that degree of power.
It's a fascinating, I had not heard that before, and I will certainly use that. So thank you for sharing it. The first thing I thought about really in response to your question is the idea that this question of the middle, this is something that initially by, I guess in a sense, being forced, and then by choice of later generations, the historiography about the Holocaust has grappled with significantly. There is an enormous literature that looks at this question of the middle. Not so much the folks who were on trial right in front of or with Robert Jackson as the prosecutor, but the people in the middle, the great mass of people who ran the Nazi state as opposed to the people directing it from the top. And in that literature, there was an enormous debate in the 70s through the 1980s about this question of whether the real engine of the final solution came from a kind of, you know, homicidal racism imposed from above, or whether instead it was much more a manifestation of much more mundane, ordinary kinds of bureaucratic striving and competition, and one agency trying to outdo the other, and one Benno Martin trying to get a promotion before the police chief in the neighboring district did. So I suspect that that literature is something that Fuller might have been quite intrigued by. The thing that in my own scholarship I am working on as I work more and more years at this stuff about the incarceration of Japanese Americans is the complete absence in the American historiography of any attention to a comparable question. All of the attention in the historiography of that episode has focused on a very, very small handful of individuals at the very top, people just one level above Carl Benditson. But there has been no acknowledgement in the American literature that this was, like slavery, like Jim Crow, like the dispossession and frankly murder of Native Americans and many other examples that we could cite, these were systems that ran with people, many of them lawyers. And so I guess the only thing I would say in response to your question to wrap up is that I would hope, and it's part of the aspiration of this paper to try to bring some attention to the middle, which is where I guess many, many years ago Professor Fuller suggested we place it.
Great. Again, I would like to thank our distinguished lecturers and invite us to continue this discussion at a reception upstairs in the Salino and Barnes Conference Center, which is on the fifth floor, room 509. Thank you again to all of you for coming and joining the lecturers.